مساء الخير. My name is Maurice Pomerantz. I'm the senior director of the NYU Abu Dhabi Institute. And tonight marks the first in an ongoing series of lectures to discuss books that the Library of Arabic Literature has recently translated. The Library of Arabic Literature makes available Arabic editions and English translations of significant works of Arabic literature with an emphasis on the 7th to the 19th century. The goal of this library is to introduce Arabic's rich literary heritage to a general audience of readers, as well as to scholars and students of the language, which brings us to our event tonight. The esteemed historian of Islam, Ho'ari To'ati, opens his work on, it's entitled Islam et Voyage, translated as Islam and Travel, with the sentence, "Muslim men of letters were mad for travel." By this madness, I think To'ati meant the extreme passion through which these men of letters cultivated the art of travel and discovery, exemplified in the writings of such legendary voyagers and storytellers as Ibn Tablan, available in the Library of Arabic Literature, al-Muqaddasi, or al-Maqdasi, Ibn Jubayr, and of course, the great Ibn Battuta, who I believe is available outside. Tonight, it is our pleasure to experience something with what the French term a folie à deux. That is a rare passion shared between two individuals. For the passion for travel and exploration that our speaker will discuss in the figure of the great 12th century scholar al-Latif al-Baghdadi, whose work Kitab al-Afada wal-Etibar is right, the title page is right up there. Translated as The Physician on the Nile, a description of Egypt and a journal of the famine years in the Library of Arabic Literature series, is a remarkable testament to the deep interest that this great physician and man of letters had for the world around him. His passion, I think, is shared in equal or perhaps not in exceeding measure by his translator and tonight's speaker, Tim Mackintosh-Smith. I first met Tim when I was a young traveler in Sana'a some 20 years ago, when my interest in Arabic literature in the broader region was just starting. And though I've seen him rarely over the intervening period, I've had the genuine readerly pleasure of following him around now for two decades. From his Yemen travels in Dictionary Land of 1998, his remarkable trilogy on Ibn Battuta, travels with a tangerine, the Hall of a Thousand Columns, and landfalls on the edge of Islam with Ibn Battuta. The last volume was published in 2010. His recent work includes this remarkable magisterial history, Arabs, a 3,000-year history of peoples, tribes, and empires, published in 2019 with Yale University Press. I'd say it's always been a pleasure to follow Tim and learn about where his voyages, real and literary, have taken him, and I hope and I trust it will be the same for you. We're incredibly fortunate to have Tim Mackintosh-Smith here in Abu Dhabi with us for a year at New York University, Abu Dhabi, as our Senior Library of Arabic Literature Fellow, where he's hard at work preparing yet another translation for the series in addition. I'm personally quite thrilled that he will be speaking with this public audience tonight. So, تفضل يا تيم.
So, good evening. Thank you very, very much, Maurice, for that resume. Somehow when you write a book, it kind of goes off and does its own thing, and you can't really believe that it's yours. It's like having a child. So. To have all these children brought together in one introduction like that, it makes me feel very proud, but also quite strange. So thank you for that, and thank you for the Institute, for letting me come here and publicize a traveler and writer who's probably less well known than many, al-Latif al-Baghdadi. And I talked about his curious gaze in the title of the talk, and he was curious in many senses. He was curious in the sense that he liked looking at things, but he was also a curious man, an unusual man. He was a physician, a medic, but he was many things besides that. So thank you to the Institute for letting me come here and publicize him, revive his memory. And thank you to the Library of Arabic Literature for bringing me here as a fellow to this sort of wonderful setting. It's like half being in half an Oxbridge college and half a sort of luxurious hotel. And it has something of the madrasa about it, but a very, very high-class madrasa. Something like the sort of up-to-date version of the Bu'anania in Fez, if you know that. You know, with the sort of sides and the rooms and the water and all these, this beautiful setting for learning. Something like that, or maybe the Mustansiriya in Baghdad, to which we will return later for a reason. So this setting could not be more different from the setting where the two of us met, as you said, 20-odd years ago, and where I worked on my edition and translation of this book, Kitab al-Ifada wal-Atibar. And I worked on it in Sana'a, in the old city, in my house, which is one of those little, it's one of those tower houses. It's quite a small tower, but it's tall and thin. And I worked on it through really the worst of the war. So while the missiles were raining down and people I knew were being killed, and it was quite horrific in many, many ways. So outside my window, I had this sort of horror which I was looking onto. And then I was working on this book, part of which is horrific, as you'll find out later. So I had the window onto the present, onto Yemen, onto the war, and this window onto the past, the horrors of the past. And strangely, I don't want to say the two negatives made a positive, but I think because al-Latif and I were both witnessing what you could call societal collapse in different ways, it sort of brought me quite close to him, in a sense. And we were talking, we had a very interesting conference, Library of Arabic Literature conference last week, and we talked a lot about things like this. And it struck me that what's important for me in translating is having a kind of empathy with the person that you're working on. And the fact that we were both watching horrors somehow brought a strange empathy into the picture. But I won't talk about Yemen in the present. I'll talk about Egypt in the very early 13th century. And I'll talk about the man who wrote this book and observed it with his curious gaze and wrote this book in Cairo. The book, to translate the title in full, the book of edification and admonition, things I witnessed and events personally observed in the land of Egypt. So obviously that's a bit long, which is why we ended up calling it a physician on the Nile, a description of Egypt in the journal of the famine years. By the way, this may very well be in his own handwriting. Different people have different opinions. I think it might be. But just to tell you what I'll talk about tonight, I'll give you a bit of background to al-Latif and to his book, and then I'll tell you how I became interested in it, which I did quite a long time ago, and how that sort of contributed to what I call that empathy, that translatorial empathy. And then I'll sort of whiz through the two parts, the edification and the admonition. And how they're connected, because they're very, very different, but they are connected in strange ways. And then I'll go on to talking about why the book isn't just a sort of curiosity. You know, we often read travelers and descriptive books and descriptive geographies and sort of think of it as, oh, it's a very interesting picture of the past. But in this case, I believe strongly it's more than a curiosity, and it has an importance to us today. Perhaps even it has a very old-fashioned word or unfashionable word. It might even have a moral to it. And then finally, I'll wind up by talking a bit about Abdul-Latif's very surprising afterlife. And talking about afterlives, Robert Irwin, who's one of our other Library of Arabic Literature translators and one of these sort of contemporary polymaths and a great guy, he talked about translation, wrote about it, and said that translation is like a seance with the dead. You know, a seance where you sit around the table and you bring the spirits of the dead into the room. And that's definitely what it's like for me. I don't want to be too whimsical about this, but I will come back to this later. And I kind of half expected, when I was sitting there in my house in Sana'a, that I would hear a voice. I will come back to that because it is very strange. And I'll come back to the strange connection between Abdul-Latif and Sir Arthur Conan Doyle, the author of, most famously, the Sherlock Holmes stories. But okay, let's start with Abdul-Latif's own life. He was born in Baghdad in 1162 in a place he calls Darb al-Faludaj, which ought to mean something like Pudding Lane. There's a Pudding Lane, and it was by the Great Fire of London started. But there was one in Baghdad as well, and that's where he was born. And he was born when Baghdad was really a shadow of its former self. In 1162. Ibn Jubayr, one of the travelers that you mentioned, Morris, in your introduction, he went there in the 1180s and said, nothing remains of it but its famous name. And it really was in the doldrums at that time. So Abdul-Latif went off, as some of you have here, to study. And of course, the journey in search of knowledge was a very important thing at the time. But it was particularly important if he came from Baghdad, where things were not so lively in the intellectual sense. And so he set off in search of knowledge and enlightenment. And I want you to keep in mind this image of knowledge as enlightenment. It's a very obvious metaphor. But Abdul-Latif himself wrote elsewhere about knowledge. Knowledge sheds a brightness, a brilliance that both illuminates and reveals its bearer, as when someone walks with a firebrand in a dark night. And it's, in Arabic, it's lovely, that last phrase, كَمَنْ يَمْشِي بِمَشْعَلٍ فِي لَيْلٍ مُدَلْهِمْ. كَمَنْ يَمْشِي بِمَشْعَلٍ فِي لَيْلٍ مُدَلْهِمْ. So this firebrand, this torch of knowledge, it's obviously a very enduring metaphor. I did my undergraduate degree at Oxford, and the college I went to, Trinity, it had stone urns all along the roof of the college with sort of copper flames of knowledge, firebrands of knowledge coming out, thanks to Sir Christopher Wren, the great architect. And, of course, is there one here? I can't see one, but the symbol of NYU. There you are. Thank you. It's the flaming torch of knowledge. So, this has a particular importance for us tonight because think of the carrier of the torch of knowledge on the dark night, and the way that the thought can reveal horrors, but at the same time, the way it casts out the darkness. So off he went. He went to Palestine. He met Saladin, as one does. But more importantly for him, he met al-Qadi al-Fadl, who was Saladin's sort of right-hand man, a very well-connected scholar. And al-Qadi al-Fadl gave him letters of introduction to Cairo. So he went to Cairo and he met people like Musa ibn Maymun, Maimonides, the very famous Jewish scholar, and others. But the scholar that he talked about most was called al-Shari'i, hardly known. I think Shawkat identified him, Shawkat Turawa, one of our colleagues, but he's hardly known at all. But for Abdul Latif, this al-Shari'i was like a sort of guru, because he took him back, he says in his autobiography, to a kind of primitive Aristotelianism, and you know, Aristotle was big, so many Arab intellectuals, but he kind of gained these accretions over the centuries, and Abdul Latif was one of the people who was looking to go back to the beginnings of what Aristotle thought, and He did go back to the beginning. He went back to the importance of what we call autopsy, which obviously it means looking at a dead body mostly these days, but it really means looking for yourself. Ayan in Arabic. And looking at phenomena, at the sort of visible outward appearances of things, and forming hypotheses and testing them and you know, obviously we're not yet at what we can call the scientific method, but look at this. Why a jawbone? How many parts does it have, if you disregard the teeth? Well, Galen, the ancient physician and anatomist, was convinced that it had two parts and that there was a join in the middle. And Abdul Latif said, no, it's got one part. So he set out to disprove Galen when he was in Egypt. And he noticed that you could actually sort of root up mummies, lots and lots of them. And he started doing this. And in the end, he looked at 2,000 jawbones. I think not altogether on his own, but with the help of colleagues and students. And he said not a single one of them had a joint in the middle. So he did that to disprove Galen. Now, if that's not empiricism, I don't know what is. And it seems to be really quite unique for the time. Even more importantly for us, he looked at these things. These are sacrums or sacra. And Galen said that they were formed of various parts. I don't know if you can see, you know, they obviously are forms of parts up there. But this one seems to be in one part. And again, he was saying, oh, Galen was wrong. The sacrum is formed of one part. It's the part at the bottom of the spine. And so he did something similar. And he looked at lots of sacrums or sacra. And he found that some of them were in several parts and some of them were in one part. So he said, I don't know. I had this hypothesis, but I couldn't prove it. And I'm not sure if I'm right or if I'm wrong. Now, that is an absolutely modern attitude. Because certainty is pre-scientific. I know it because somebody's told me or because I feel it's right. But actually going and looking at things and disproving yourself, that is really the basis of the scientific method. So I would say that 800 years ago, he was employing the sort of techniques that we only think of as really appearing with people like Bacon at the beginning of the 17th century. So, yeah, certainty is pre-scientific, doubt is scientific. And So going back to Aristotle, Abdul Latif saw himself as the carrier of a torch in a sort of intellectual relay that went from Aristotle through Galen, through Arabic writing scholars, up to his present day. And he said somewhere else, knowledge moves from nation to nation and from land to land. Keep that in mind as well. But he always went back to Aristotle. And he quotes Aristotle, a lovely, beautiful passage of Aristotle in his book that I translated. And I want to read it. In everything in the world of nature, there is something to be marveled at. We ought therefore to strive to understand the natural characteristics of every single species of living creature, and to be aware that in all creatures there is something of these characteristics that is noble. The reason for this innate virtue is this, that nothing formed by nature is ever devoid of some purpose or other, nor do natural forms turn up by chance or result from luck. No. Everything that exists by virtue of nature can only exist for something, I mean to contribute to a state of perfection. And as such, it has gained its rightful place, its due rank, and its proper merit. So that sort of all-encompassing holistic view, it's greatly affected Abdul Latif, and he took it on board in its entirety. But he really moved it into an Islamic setting, and he saw that light of knowledge, of course, as coming from God. And so almost immediately on top of that, he celebrates the cosmos and looking at everything in these words, which are touched by, they're very beautiful in the original. And they end with a Quranic quotation. Blessed is he, blessed is God, by whose power the manifest forms of all existent things derive their being, and by whose will they are in motion or at rest. In the execution of whose commands fulfilled in themselves these beings delight, rejoicing in their own proximity to the presence of his sanctity, whose unity is affirmed by their plurality and whose eternity is avowed by their mutability. And there is not a thing but it proclaims his glory. So he's taken this sort of panoramic panoptic gaze of Aristotle, where you have to look at everything from worms to whales and the stars, and he has transferred it into an Islamic setting. And he looks, what do we say in Arabic? Min al-thara ila thuraya, from the earth beneath our feet to the Pleiades in heaven. And this sort of overwhelmingly curious gaze at everything. It produced so many works. There's a bibliography that's contemporary to him, and it lists 173 titles, 53 on medicine, 48 on philosophy, and there are more that aren't on that list that we still have today. So, okay, let's go back to the Egypt book and talk a bit about why he wrote it, because even though Baghdad was in decline, the Abbasid caliph of the time, Nasser, was trying to revive the caliphate and its prestige. And Abdul Latif saw himself as traveling through the caliph's realms, his nominal realms at least, and he wanted to describe them for the caliph and serve the caliph and thereby serve God. So that's really his stated aim for writing this particular book. Okay, well, how did I get interested in it? Who hasn't looked at mummies and pyramids and been fascinated by them? I was as a small boy, but I was indulged by this gentleman, Leslie Grinstall, and we all called him Uncle Leslie. He was the sort of friend of the family, and he was a very distinguished Egyptologist, and I would sit with him, and he took me through Gardiner's Egyptian Grammar, the great book of if you want to learn hieroglyphs. So that's Uncle Leslie. This is his book from the 1940s, I think, on the pyramids. I was very lucky to be tutored by this gentleman back in my teens. And he got me a job in the local museum that had a very good Egyptology section. And I was, God knows why, but I was let loose on something called the map collection. Nothing to do with maps, but there were two Mrs. Map who in the 1880s gave a load of Egyptian antiquities to Bristol City Museum. And nobody had ever catalogued them. And there was they knew that there was nothing important in them, so they gave the lot to me and said, catalogue them. And so I would sit there typing away on an old typewriter and doing cards. There's a silly story that I will never forget. In the course of this, I found a mummified foot detached. So I just on the table and started typing foot, human, mummified, detached. And I measured it, and it was so many centimeters long. And then I thought, well, it's a foot, so I ought to give a shoe size. And I slipped off one of my shoes for comparison, slipped the foot into the shoe. I'm not making this up, at that minute, footstep came down the corridor of the empty cellars of the museum. And it was I think it was Georgina, my boss. And she sort of took one look at this mummified foot in my shoe and said, that's weird. I was really indulged in my interest. And then after I started studying Arabic, I got to know the real life Cairo. This is Habiba, my favorite Cairene. And we're on the roof of her house, which, as you can see, is in the shadow of the mausoleum of Pipe Bay. And so she sort of introduced me to the living Cairo. And then, about 25 years ago, I came across this, which is there are two translations of al-Latif's book, and this is the first one, The Eastern Key. So we'll come back to this a bit later, but I seized upon it and read it, and it's got a lovely photographic facsimile of the manuscript. And inspired by this, I wrote this little book, Ghostwriter, which doesn't appear on many of my bibliographies. Again, I'll return to this later. But let's go back to this book. God knows why they called it The Eastern Key. Let's go back to al-Latif's book. So two parts, Ifada and E'tibar. Kitab al-Ifada wal-E'tibar, the book of edification and admonition. So in other words, informing and warning. And the information bit, it starts with that dedication to the caliph, and then there's a kind of general bit on Egypt, and it centers a lot on the Nile and the importance of the Nile. Obviously, in Egypt, it's what keeps the whole place alive. And from the Nile, which produces all these crops, he goes on to plants, the flora and the agricultural products. And I'm just showing you this banana with its bud at the bottom. Which he calls the mother of the banana. And he has several pages of minute description, almost as beautiful and as detailed as this drawing. He talks, for example, about the famous balsam, which was grown in Cairo at the time, which supposedly grew up watered by a spring that appeared when the Holy Family visited Egypt. And he talks about things like these jumeis. I'm not sure, are they sycamore figs in English? And the fact that you have to, the word in still used these days is hat, circumcision. Somebody has to climb the tree and circumcise each fig, in other words, cut round it, because otherwise they don't become sweet. And so he talks about plants, he talks about animals. For example, these poor skinks, which have been long celebrated as an aphrodisiac, and they're still sold. Or last time I was in Cairo, you could still buy a dry skink in the Khan al Khalili to pep up your marital life. And he talks at great length about egg factories. And, you know, the fact that they're a means of hatching eggs by artificial heat. And there's a wonderfully detailed description of these. Then he goes on and talks about buildings and boats and dishes and recipes. One of the best recipes I've ever come across in any cookbook is for a sort of picnic pie, which includes 3 sheep and 90 birds of various sorts. It's obviously a very big pie, and the Sultan would have them made when he went hunting. And al-Latif says, oh, and if you feel like it, you can add an extra sheep. So it's really this wonderful description of life, flora, fauna, cookery, everything else. But the star one, the star chapter in the information part of the book is on antiquities. So he talks obviously about the pyramids. This is the pyramid of Menkaure, or Mykerinos in Greek. And he actually talks as an eyewitness about how it got this scar, which was somebody sort of bet the Ayyubid Sultan at the time that he wouldn't be able to demolish it, and that's as far as he got. He saw the Sphinx still with its nose, perhaps not in this sort of Photoshop perfection, but interestingly, it was buried up to its neck. So when he gets the dimensions wrong, the imagined dimensions, you have to think he was thinking of it perhaps as a standing figure. And he goes to Alexandria, talks about Pompey's pillar. All these are expected, but there are unexpected things. For example, at Memphis, there was a monolithic little miniature temple hewn out of a single stone called the Green Chamber, which was broken up in the 14th century. And there's a lovely description of this by al-Latif. And it's gone now. There's just a few bits of it left. Here, this bottom part. I don't know. I couldn't find a decent picture, but you can just see the tops of hieroglyphs. And, you know, all of this is from this Green Chamber, which was greatly celebrated at the time. It's now built into a Sufi hospice built by Amir Sheikhoun. And, you know, this gaze of his that's curious, it looks into little things that you wouldn't, other people don't notice. So he notices things like masonry clamps and, you know, hypothesizes about the kind of metal that they used. And most beautifully of all, he talks about statuary. And here's a passage, perhaps even about this very famous colossus of Ramses II. He says, if you look closely at such an idol, he calls them asnam, but not in a pejorative sense, if you look closely at such an idol, you will see with what eloquent proportion the trunk commences at the division of the chest from the neck of the clavicle, then how the chest begins to rise at the upper rib towards the pectoral muscles. These ascend further to their apex at the nipple, which is depicted in proper proportion to the whole vast figure. The chest then slopes down to the depression above the sternum and the metasternum, also to the corrugations and the undulations of the lower rib, all depicted just as in the actual living being. On and on it goes. I mean, it goes on for several pages. And you can see his huge delight in his aesthetic enjoyment of these sculptures, which of course comes from him being so interested in anatomy. And this even inspires rhyming prose. I try to imitate the rhyme in English. The utmost accomplishment man could achieve, and the most perfect embellishment stone could receive. So that rhyming rhythmic prose, Kaja, which he uses very sparingly, but he uses it about these sculptures. And he talks about the sculptures and the pyramid buildings with their noble intellects, their pure minds, their enlightened souls. He talks about the people who robbed the tombs as ignoramuses and imbeciles, wanton and puerile vandals. So plenty of people wrote about Pharaonica and Egyptian things, Egyptian, going back to Mithridates in the 10th century, but nobody wrote about them with this wonderful sort of searching eye that loved the beauty. And it's all part of what I would dare to call his rather modern gaze. Okay, so that's the edification, information, the informing. What about the warning? And, well, I didn't know what to show you to go with this, but I've picked out this painting by Goya. And really, to go with this, I have to quote from him. Then came the year 7, that monstrous year, that predatory date, 7, the severer of lives. And 7 is short for 597, AH, which in the Hijri calendar, which works out as 1200 to 1201 AD. And what my translation tries to do there is reflect the fact that in Arabic, 7 is an alternative vocalization to sabr, and the sabr is a beast, particularly a predatory beast. So, you know, really in 7, in Arabic, 7 is the number of the beast. And this horrible year began in which the Nile didn't rise. So he talks about the Nile and why it didn't rise. Some of you may have seen this. It's the Nilometer. And I think it was first instituted, was it the 9th century AD? Correct me if I'm wrong. But it measures the rises of the Nile. And when it gets up to 16 cubits, it's called the Ma'a Sultan, the Sultan's water. And at that point, you can begin to take taxes from the farmers. Anything less than that, you can't. And in this year, I don't think it got up to 12. And the following year, it was even worse. So you had 2 years in which the Nile failed to rise. And people hadn't taken precautions. You put enough food in stores, so the food ran out. And the prices of the staple foods rose and rose. And as always, the poor people suffered. The masakin, the paupers, that lowest sort of rung on the social ladder. And it really is a harrowing read. I warn you. If you want to read this, if you haven't read the book, it's most disturbing. It's one of the most disturbing things ever written. I'll just read you one little bit to give you an idea, because this famine set off a wave of cannibalism. And here he is. The story that gained wide circulation was heard out of the prefect's own mouth, concerned a woman who had appeared before him unveiled and in a state of shock. She said she was a midwife and that some people had called for her and during her visit had given her a plate of sikbaj stew, beautifully cooked and flavored with all the appropriate spices. When she realized, however, that it was particularly rich in meat, and that this meat was different from normal meat, the discovery turned her stomach. She managed to get a word in private with a little girl of the family and asked her about the meat. "Oh," said the girl, "Mrs. So-and-so, the fat lady, came to visit, and Daddy cut her throat. There she is, hanging up in bits." And it's, you couldn't make it up. And there's story after story, and I mean, that one is a more repeatable one. And, you know, the effect on the mesakin, the paupers, the poorest class, was absolutely apocalyptic. I think in the 2 years of famine, I've got the number here, during the 2 years of famine, the Sultan's charitable diwan contributed to 110,000 funerals. And those were just the people who got a decent burial, and just the ones in Cairo. So think of the ones across the country. And I want to read just one more bit from this very disturbing part of the book, where Abdul-Latif visits something that he calls Uskurjat Fir'aun. Now, I don't know if any of you Arabic speakers or Arabists know the word Uskurja. I had to look it up. It means something like a bowl for pickles. So it's a little bowl. But this was, in fact, a big bowl. And it's a bit like when there are places in Britain that are called things like the Devil's Punch Bowl. So it's a geographical feature. And he says, we emerged into a place called Uskurjat Fir'aun, Pharaoh's pickle bowl. Here we saw every single bit of ground, chock full of bodies and dismembered remains. The dead had taken over the hillocks here so completely that they covered every spot and almost exceeded in quantity the dust of the hummocks. And when we looked down into the Uskurja itself, an enormous depression in the ground, we saw the skulls, white, black, dark brown, stacked on top of each other in layers. To an onlooker, they resembled a newly cut crop of watermelons heaped together at harvest. I saw them again some days later when the sun had scorched the flesh off them and they had turned white. This time they seemed to me like ostrich eggs piled up. So, to me, that's an unforgettable image. It's like watching the killing field, or it sticks in the mind. And there was more horror to come. On top of the famine, there was an epidemic. And we're not quite sure what the particular disease was, but in Alexandria, in one day at its height, there were 700 deaths. And when Ibn Battuta passed through Alexandria in the Black Death, I think there were 1,000. So it was two-thirds as bad as the Black Death. It must have been something terrible. And then there was an earthquake. And the earthquake caused a tsunami in the Mediterranean. I quote Abdul-Latif, "The waves of the sea piled up and raged. In places the sea parted, and the wave crest rose up like great mountains. Ships ended up aground, and the sea cast many fish upon its shores." And there's an allusion in the Arabic to the account of the parting of the Red Sea for Moses. And it just seemed to him that the whole of the earth that he could see was unbalanced. Its humoral temperament, as the physician of the time would have said, was out of balance. It was out of kilter. So, having talked about that sort of pretty first part, informing, and the horrific second part, the warning, how does he stitch them together? In interesting ways, I believe. He talks about the piles of mummies that he investigated, and then he talks about the piles of the dead from the famine, and he says that the dead of the famine were in a worse condition than the mummies. So, thousands of years hadn't done the work of just a few weeks or months. And most importantly, he talks about the Nile. He began with the Nile, and he talks about the Nile, obviously the fertile second Nile, growing all these crops to begin with. And then in the second half, it's, I think the word he uses is muhtarak. It's burnt out. And the whole tragedy, it only ends when the Nile flows again. And he says, the river surged with enormous force, one rise following hard upon another, mountains of water all turning together in state. So again, you have mountains of water. We've just had the mountains of water, of waves, of the tsunami, and now we've got the beneficent mountains of the Nile. And that's where the book ends. So it ends on that kind of note. And honestly, you read the thing, and you get to the Nile flowing again, and you breathe a sigh of relief, because we know that there's hope for Egypt and hope for humanity. All right. I said at the beginning that he wrote it, he dedicated it to the caliph, Nasser. And I wonder if he actually got him a copy. I don't think he did. I think he wanted to present a copy in person to the caliph. And by the time he got back to Baghdad in 1231, Nasser had been dead for some years. And his grandson, al-Mustansir, was now caliph. And I like to think that he gave a copy to al-Mustansir, perhaps angling for a job in the Mustansiriya Madrasa, which was brand new at the time. So like this, as I said, the NYU Abu Dhabi of the time. But we don't know, and he died in that year. And all we have is that single copy that he wrote in Cairo in 1204. And just to talk a tiny bit about the history of the manuscript, it was found in Aleppo, where quite possibly Abdul-Latif took it himself. He lived in Aleppo for many years. And it was bought in Aleppo in the 17th century by Edward Pocock, chaplain of the English Turkey merchants. The merchants, and not poultry salesmen, but merchants in the Ottoman Empire. And Pocock was their chaplain. He was an Arabist and a Hebraist as well, and he became eventually the first Lordian professor of Arabic at Oxford, which is why the manuscript is now in the Bodleian Library. And so that's another case. I like to think Abdul-Latif would have liked the idea of knowledge moving from land to land. Well, you might ask, in a sense, what the point of it all is. All right, it's interesting to read. It's fodder for libraries. It gives somebody like me fascinating work to do. But is there a further point to it all, to this book? And do you remember we talked in the conference about relevance? And I think James Montgomery was insistent on the irrelevance of relevance. And I tend to agree with him. I don't think books need to be relevant. But I would say that good books are relevant in spite of themselves. And that's really the sort of mark of a great book. And I think it's the mark of this book. And I might not even have noticed it had I not been working on it in Sana'a during the war, where people were being killed. And there I was reading about people being killed to be eaten, but people dying of hunger. And of course, in Yemen, people are dying of hunger. And it just made me think. I know people who've been killed on the front, fighting. I don't know anyone who's died of hunger. I just don't know them. As a sort of comfortably off person, praise God, I don't know them as Akeem. But here they are in this book. And he gives them a voice. Abdul-Latif gives them a Sakina voice. He records their suffering. He actually records what they say in some instances. And that's a point of great importance to me as a historian. It reminds me that I must listen to the voices of the poor, who don't usually have a voice. But there's also another point which affects the Masakin. It affected them then, it affects them now, it affects all of us, even us living in comfort. And that's the fact that Abdul-Latif was watching the failure of an ecosystem. He was watching the failure of the Nile to rise, and he was watching the failure of that whole agricultural system in Egypt, and he knew that the only hope to mitigate future failure was in science in its original meaning of knowledge, which meant the recording and the analysis of data. Now, he wrote another book on Egypt, which seems to have been lost either in his lifetime or soon after, but he talks about it in our book, and he says that he had a chapter that had the annual report of the Nile's rises going back hundreds of years. And he says his aim in this was, I quote, to reveal any relationships that might exist between annual data and any symptoms displayed by them. Such information might identify which of the phenomena recur. We would then be able to make the knowledge thus gained available in advance in order to be on the alert and to give warning of foreseeable events. Again, doesn't that sound modern? And, you know, today we need to be on the alert, very obviously, about the whole Earth, not just about the Nile. And I feel strongly that this is part of the importance of this book, that it shows us that even then, 800 years ago, somebody was thinking about this. And I feel strongly as well that if Abdul-Latif were with us now, he would be somewhere at the forefront of climate science. He would be collecting data, recommending action, and suggesting ways to balance the humoral temperament of the planet, as he would have put it. And, you know, just think of the four humors and the four qualities and the four, you know, this is what's wrong with the planet these days. They're not in balance. Now, humor, of course, has another meaning, and I don't want you to think that he was a humorless man. Even in the midst of that enormous tragedy, he could be funny. I have to quote this story. It's where he's talking about one of his colleagues, another physician. And it's sort of laughing in the face of tragedy to stave it off. So he talks about this other physician who was asked by somebody to visit a sick person. And off the physician went and noticed that the man who'd engaged him was behaving very strangely. He was giving out alms and was sort of putting himself up as a great alms giver, but in a rather strange way. And he was taking the physician deeper and deeper into this kind of maze of alleyways. And I'll read the little story, it's short. Even so, the doctor's mind was put at ease by the lure of good fat fees. And that's another instance where he has a bit of pejack, rhyming rhythmic prose. Eventually, however, when the man led him into a big tumble-down house, his sense of foreboding increased, and he paused on the stairs. The man went up ahead of him and knocked on a door. Out came a crony of his, saying, "You've taken your time. Have you caught us a bit of game that's worth the wait?" When he heard this, the physician turned to jelly. Luckily for him, there happened to be a window nearby, and he threw himself out of it and landed in a stable, only to find the owner of the stable coming over to him saying, "What's the matter with you then?" Hearing the words from the keeper of the stable, too, the physician did not let on. But the man said, "Don't tell me it's that lot in this house here luring people to the slaughter." And I think that's a consciously funny story told in the face of disaster. But okay, just to wind up, because time is just whizzing by. Are we all right to wind up with why I half expected that I might hear Abdul-Latif's voice directly in my house in Sana'a in the dark during our power cut, which began in August 2015 and is still going on, would you believe it? It's a very strange story indeed. And it involves this gentleman, Sir Arthur Conan Doyle, who was very interested in spiritualism, the idea that we can communicate with the souls of the dead via the voices of living mediums. And you know those films where you get mediums. If you've seen the brilliant film of Blight Spirit, a 1940s film, and she says, "Is anybody there? Is anybody there?" And they're all sitting around and trying to, and this is what spiritualism is about, bringing the spirits in. And strangely enough, this lady, Miss Etta Vreet of Detroit, who was a noted medium, was holding a seance, and up popped Abdul-Latif. He soon got onto the sort of airwaves of seances, and he started popping up left, right, and center. Conan Doyle, as you saw, was very interested in spiritualism. Conan Doyle wrote this in 1929. "I have been brought into contact more than once with Abdul and was privileged once to sit for more than an hour listening to his account of his life, with anecdotes of ancient Cairo, Saladin, the Crusaders, and many other events which occurred under his own eyes. It was a unique experience to partake of the ripe, gentle wisdom of this great sage, never bitter, never sarcastic, eminently reasonable and courteous, answering through the lips of an unconscious woman." I don't know actually if his contemporaries would have agreed that he was never sarcastic. Some of them thought he was really, really spiky. And they used to call, some people used to call him a mapudgin, which ought to mean something like the maker or the seller of pajins, you know, those things that you make stews in. But I think it might have a sense, we don't use it anymore, but it might have a sense of something like Mr. Potboiler. People were kind of envious of him and envious of his writing abilities. Back to Conan Doyle, author of Sherlock Holmes, spiritualist with a friend. Somewhere in a box in England, I have a photograph of my grandfather with Conan Doyle in a garden. And my grandfather was quite into spiritualism, so I never knew him. He died before I was born, but I like to think that he met Abdul-Latif as well, and lots of people did. And one of those who did was an English woman called Mrs. Ivy Vivian. And this is from the introduction to that other English version of Abdul-Latif's book, the one with the red cover, which was published in 1965 by George Allen and Unwin in London, a reputable publisher. And this is what Mrs. Vivian says in her intro. Our first meeting with al-Latif was in August 1957, when he spoke to my husband and to me during a conversation with a sensitive, Mrs. Ray Welsh, in London. Since then, we have had many long talks with him through Mrs. Welsh and also through Mr. Jim Hutchings. It was not unexpected, therefore, that he should tell us in 1960 that he wished my husband to make a photographic copy of the Bodleian manuscript of Kitab al-Ifada. Al-Latif promised to prepare the way for the accomplishment of this plan, adding later that he would send a translator from Baghdad. They needed the translator, the Mr. and Mrs. Vidian. They didn't, as far as I can tell, they didn't understand a word of Arabic. Al-Latif was as good as his word. And up turned somebody called Kamal Hafiz Zand, who was apparently a judge. I've tried to find more about him, I can't. And he apparently helped them translate the book. But I think they got most of their help from Sylvestre de Sacy, the great French orientalist of the 19th century, who did the most wonderfully rich and pedantic and thick version of Abdullahi's book. There's a footnote on a tree that runs to 30 pages. That's a footnote. And he still doesn't identify what the tree was. And neither could I in my meager footnote. So, anyway, this was the apparent reappearance of Abdullatif in the 20th century. And you might feel that you should be skeptical about this. Allen and Unwin, the publishers of Tolkien, the publishers of Roald Dahl, so they were quite into the fantastical. I think more important than this, Abdullatif as a good Muslim, first of all, and as a scientist, would have completely poo-pooed the idea of his appearing after death. But despite all of this, when I was working on him in my dark room in summer, in the endless power cut, I longed for him to appear. Did he? Well, not in Sana'a, but in 2019, I went to England after an absence of about 5 years because of the war. And the first thing I did was I went to Oxford. It was November. It was a misty night, and it was dark by the time I got there. And I went straight to the Bodleian Library. And Alistair Watson, who looks after the Arabic manuscripts, was still there. He was working late. And I hadn't told him I was coming. They called him down, and he sort of looked at me and, "Oh, it's you. We thought you were..." And I said, "You thought I was dead? I sometimes wonder if I am myself." And then he sort of realized that I'd come to see al-Latif. And there was the manuscript. And there's nothing like... And you who've worked on manuscripts, the joy, the excitement, the ecstasy of seeing the real thing after looking at a scan, looking at that polished paper, at that chiseled script. And here it was, and it's the only survivor. It's the single known copy, and still there after more than 800 years. So it brings to mind what Al-Jahed said, that a book is a silent talker, the speaker who can speak for the dead and yet interpret the living. It brings to mind for me what Milton said, books are not absolutely dead things, but do contain a potency of life in them. And I'll give the manuscript the very last word, and this comes from that little book that I wrote called Ghostwriter. Because the manuscript actually spoke to me, spoke through me as its medium. and the manuscript ends up saying this. So, is anybody there? Only us. We books alone are the voices of the dead, of our authors, of Mrs. So-and-so, the fat lady, of the skulls in Pharaoh's pickle bowl, of all the dead from the dawn of writing to yesterday's newspaper crying in the wilderness of the library, while famine and pestilence and earthquake and tsunami and war do their worst and always will. Don't think it odd that we don't speak. Don't think it odd that we do speak, only that people don't hear. So that was al-Latif speaking to me in his book, and that is part of the importance of what we do with these manuscripts. And on that note, I'll say thank you for hearing and listening. And that's it.